Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the World Economic Forum on Africa. Welcome to Cape Town and welcome to our first session, Africa Brainstorming. It really, really is wonderful to have you all here. And one of the reasons we start with this session is because we want to start on an inspirational note. We want to start by getting you working. So that it sets the tone, really, for the next 2.5 days. It's an inspirational kickoff for the summit, which is being held, as you know, under the theme From Vision to Action, Africa's Next Chapter. And I think everyone would agree that where Africa is right now, we've moved from the concept of having a potential to actually being at the point where we need to take vision and all the visions that we all have for what this continent is going to look like and turn them into actual action. And that's what this afternoon is going to be about. My name is Siki, Mgabadeli. I'll be your moderator for this particular session. It is a working session, so I'm gonna explain exactly what is happening, what's going to be happening over the next hour and a half. One of the things that is really being reflected in the theme and some of the sessions that you're going to be attending over the next couple of days is the need for leadership. And leadership not just in the political sense, because I think often we over-rely on political leadership, forgetting that there are other types of leadership. There's business leadership, there's leadership in communities, there's leadership in civil society, and then of course, there's the individual leadership that is also needed. So those are some of the things that I'm sure we're going to see reflected in what you are going to be coming up with this afternoon. So let me explain the concept and what we're going to be doing. We've created 5 different avatars who are really a reflection of some of the people in our communities, some of the people in our countries and our businesses and from all walks of life who are going through some of the issues that you will see when we introduce the avatars to you. So they're fictional people, and what we're asking you to do is to take their vision for Africa and give us some concrete, actionable plans, ideas of how they can turn their visions into reality. So we're going to introduce them to you shortly, and we're all going to be sitting together brainstorming, and then we're going to discuss some of the issues that actually come up and some of the action items that you are going to be coming up from. So what they are really, these avatars, are conversation starters. So it's you're not limited to what is there. It just starts the conversation, if you understand what I mean by that. And something else I'm going to encourage you to do is, as you explore the avatar's visions, think about the success stories around you, the people that you know that have really achieved, and maybe pick that out and put it down as an action item, but I'm not going to preempt what you are going to do. So we're going to have a 30-minute brainstorm session, and during that time, the conversations are going to start flowing, and what we're asking at the end of that 30-minute is that you, on a piece of paper, have 3 action items that you've put down, which we are then going to discuss for about 45 minutes. So I'll give you a time at about 15 minutes. When there's 15 minutes left, I'll let you know. And then if you can hand in that particular piece of paper with an action item, all you need to do once you're done is just lift up your hand and someone will come from the back to come and pick up your action item. Right, let's get you introduced to the avatars, and we've got a number of young global leaders in the room who are going to be assisting me today, and I'm going to ask Alan Knott Craig to please introduce Oyore. He's coming. Is it on?
Hello everyone. Oyore is 16, lives in an area with good access to the web. In his free time, he spends hours connected with friends around the world. He wants to use the internet's potential for political youth mobilization. My vision is a new generation of democratic leadership for Africa.
Thanks, Alan. If I could ask Yolanda Xuba to please introduce Abra, and she's over here. If we could have a microphone, please stand up, Yolanda. There we go.
Hi, I'm sure everyone can read. Abra is 46. She's energetic, and she's got a successful business that she's running, a manufacturing business. And all she wants for Africa is less bottlenecks in terms of infrastructure. And she wants to be able to make sure that there's access to facilitate development, economic development for Africa. Thanks.
Tumi Makhabo, please introduce Hawa.
Thank you. Hawa is 19 and lives in a small rural village. She hasn't been to school and now looks after her young family. She's unemployed, but she is creative, of course, resourceful, and passionate about design specifically. And her vision is to develop the necessary skills and find financing to start her own clothing business.
Thanks, Tumi. And if I could ask Salim Amin to introduce Suzanne. It's off again.
It's off. Hello? Okay, got it. Suzanne is 30 years old. She's created an NGO which helps facilitate the creation of corporate programs to provide healthcare for employees. Her vision is an Africa where health no longer impedes growth.
Thanks, Salim. And finally, Paul Capellos, if you could please introduce Aristide.
Aristide is 58, he's the oldest of the lot. And he's been a miner all his life. His work conditions have been difficult, and he sees very little social protection. His vision is an Africa that can use its rich resources in a more inclusive manner and improve the lives of his grandchildren.
Thank you very much. You've met your avatars, and you will see whose vision you are turning into action in front of you on your table. The white box is not only a working station for you, it's also somewhere where we'd like you to scribble messages, anything you'd like to say, as many messages as possible, whatever you'd like to say, you can use that as, I'd call it a venting box. All right, we're going to start our brainstorming session right now, and I'll let you know when we are halfway through. Let's start the conversation. Ladies and gentlemen, just a reminder, when you are done with your first action item, at the back of the room, sorry, I see people are looking for me on stage, just raise your hand and wave it in the air, and then someone will pick it up from you, all right? Action, work.
Yagna sori, amna sori, filo sori sori, mletak nyawo, sumadan sori, sumadan sori man, filo sori sori, mletak nyawo. Lord, I can't move him go. Sumadan, sorry. Sumadan, sorry, man. Feel oh, sorry, sorry. Mladak nya.
Thank you. simban sai na mai jama mita fasote mangaine mangaina wa kena marna
Don ribemoh bukelang makomu Don tombadisa don ribemoh bukelang makomu
Karitabanya na tsatawa halakhala mamela hanta temuhulu andare lesike
Singing it up and salobi, Bonabana. chercher na bango to sigi demokrasi na Afrika to yokana mabele hoyo ya bana heritage na bango to sigi anilasyo ya bete na bako Héritage na bango, et bon vite préparé à venir. Pour singi justice.
Sana makoko Oto tombola ikulu na biso Bana bako mana Yele ye Bangonde bako tunga Kaya Obie Nusabana Avenir yabana Besa
Hi. Oh, I'm just eavesdropping.
Oh, you eavesdropping. You know, we've been a very productive table, at least four of our things.
Right up there.
We might need like 2 or 3 minutes just to finish inputting everything because I feel like it's going to be a massive clash. So you can start with a foray
yeah.
and say, hey, table.
Hey, we got 5 minutes.
Yeah,
say table thingy. Yeah, I heard you say this about a foray. And then you can start the conversation and then it'll show up.
Okay,
but we just need 2 or 3 minutes, not
yeah.
that you're surprised.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have 5 minutes left. So please, if you haven't put in your action items, please do so at this point. Okay. I'm eavesdropping. How are you? Good to see you. Thank you. I'll take it with you. fits for Africa.
When we went around the group here, there were so many examples of different models that have worked in Nigeria. Let's not reinvent the wheel.
Yeah.
Let's look at what works and then decide by country what the private sector has to do, because there's too much reinvent.
Yeah. Okay. Tired.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more minute left and the end of the exam. So please, if you haven't handed in your last action item, please do that at this point, and we're going to start in just under a minute.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, if we could all settle down, please, so we can get our room-wide discussion started. I hope you've all handed in all three of your action items. It is the first session of the World Economic Forum on Africa, so I know everybody's catching up. And I'm trying to talk as loud as I can. Yolanda? Was it you? It wasn't. All right, if we could all settle down so we can start getting through this. I didn't introduce Alicia. Alicia is actually the person who drew the avatars, and she's going to be drawing what we are talking about here as we continue to talk about it. So sorry, Alicia, for not introducing you. Right, we're going to start the discussion, and really, I want to do as little talking as possible. Because I heard some of the discussions that you were having during the brainstorm. I did my favorite thing. I was eavesdropping at people's tables. So if you were busy sharing secrets, I now know everything. So what I'm going to ask, there are roving microphones. I might pick on certain tables because I might have picked up on something at that point. But if it relates in any way to any of the avatar, even if it's a different avatar to the one that you are focusing on. If there is something that links to your one, I'd be quite happy for you to share it with the room. And any of the examples that were taken forward by some of the people who brought them up here as well. So we're going to start with Ayore. And I'm sure, I don't know if you were too busy in your discussions, but a lot of things were floating up above us, and that's his vision, a new generation of democratic leadership for Africa. And I have to tell you, some interesting debates in the Oyore Row when I was walking up and down it, because I think we all have our different ideas about how to get to that point. I think there's very few people who will say we don't want to get there, but how to get there was very, very interesting to listen to people talking about it. So some of the examples, and there's a lot of focus on mobile phones. We've seen a huge explosion in mobile phone technology around the world, and this was something that I found was common across all the avatars, that people were talking about using mobile phones, whether it is for helping people to express their ideas, in Oyore's case, or when it came to, who was it? Let me just find it. Oh, Hawa heard a conversation at Dumi's table where they were talking about mix it, you know, sharing information there and making it easily available on someone's mobile phone, because people on this continent, some of them have 2, 3, 4 mobile phones. So it's probably going to be the cheapest way to get that information out there. So just taking a look at some of the issues that came up there, and as you can see, you'll know what came from your specific table. But if we can just maybe just talk about Oyore, because many people were saying that we need to go back to basics. Table 23, maybe someone at table 23 wants to pick up on this. I heard someone there saying there is huge political youth mobilization taking place right now, and maybe what young people need is space to vent. Anyone there want to pick it up for me? To give them space to tell people, governments, what they want. There's a microphone right behind you, sorry.
We as a team, we picked up on the mobile phone issue early on, and I think the debate quickly turned to providing a framework so that if these portals do exist, you know, what will they be used for? You know, depending on the government or the regime, it could be used to either find the warning signs early, act on them and deal with them,
yeah.
Or alternatively, it's also an easy way to find the so-called rabble-rousers and stop it. And so, you know, step one was creating the legislative framework, almost a pact that countries can sign up to for a freedom of information, starting with, you know, with the rights for youth to communicate. Two for us was creating a platform for those views to then be expressed using existing social media. So some are doing it, you know, governments using Facebook, Mixit and other platforms, but with a kind of agreement or moratorium, this is what this would be used for, and then some kind of civic monitoring of that. So those were some of the ideas.
Any other ideas along? So anyone who wants to add to that, I think what we saw in North Africa, people were saying, you know, it's the first internet revolution that they've ever seen. So that might, in one way or another, apply to what you were talking about. But anyone who wants to add to that? Up your hand quite high. Well, while you're thinking about that, I saw another one a few seconds ago on there. I can't remember what table it was, but it said, oh, there it is, table 26. Get him a job. Economic freedom will lead to political empowerment. Will it? Thoughts? What did you say? There are no schools. Your thoughts on that? I host here in South Africa a national radio program, and people always call in and they say, you know, we've got political freedom, but we need economic freedom. That one seems to be saying it's going to come the other way around. So thoughts on from Oyore? Table 26, what's a democratic book? Someone could just explain to us what that means. Someone, anyone? I think they're debating on who's going to tell us. They ran away. Maybe they've gone to get Oyore a job. All right, what we're going to do is move on and maybe talk a little bit about Hawa, because I also spent a lot of time talking about her. And hers was really a very, very practical vision. Developing the necessary skills and find financing to start my own clothing business. And I'm going to say that when it comes to skills and comes to education, It wasn't related to Howard. It was another conversation I was listening to on Aristide, but we're going to stick with Howard, so don't change that particular screen. But I heard someone saying education, education, education. But in relation to Howard, I heard people talking about the need for apprenticeship for her. Maybe she can understudy someone who is already doing whatever it is that she'd like to do. People asking where and how is she going to be able to actually access all of these skills and all of the information. It's one thing to say to us that, you know, go get an education, but where and how? And that's where the tool like Mixit I got from table 18. And stories were also being shared at table 20, something about a chief's wife. And then they caught me eavesdropping, and then I had to walk away. Was that part of the brainstorm, or were you gossiping? I wouldn't want you to have to repeat it. Would you like to share it with us? Is it? It is table 20.
No, it was part of a brainstorming session. I mean.
Okay.
Was a typical example from Mali, not Niger, where we operate. And in that community, the chief's wife happens to be the most wealthy. And depending on how much she trusts you, she'll give you vegetables to go sell for 1 week. Depending on the trust, 3 days, 2 days, and within a day, 3-4 hours, you have to come back and pay her. So we thought that there's that amount of peer pressure. If she doesn't trust you, you don't get credit on vegetables at all. If she trusts you, a week, credit, and you come back and pay. So we thought that in that same environment, you could have some form of social pressure, giving Hawa some form of credit without collateral, without you bringing your mother's land title, your father's access to secure credit. That's the context in which we're discussing the chief's wife.
Thank you. I did think it was part of the brainstorm, but you know. All right. Let's talk a little bit about accessing these skills, and maybe you can throw around some ideas. You don't have to have been looking at Hauer to actually share your thoughts on that. In a case where there isn't easy access to the kind of skills that Hauer wants to have, maybe there isn't a college around the corner, maybe she's raising her brothers and sisters. You know, her story could be almost anything. It could expand. We've just given you a snapshot. What is being done? What can people do? What is some of the thinking? What is being done in some areas to make sure, or at least give someone like Hauer an opportunity to start her own clothing business? Any thoughts? Maybe you can give us a practical example. There's someone here.
Our group was one of those asked to look at Hauer's context. And some of the stories we shared showed that there were obviously lots of Hauers in our society, and particularly in Africa, and that we needed to have a mix of focusing on building skills for her, focusing on her getting support because she's a young woman who has a young family. And so if she's going to start a business, we need to also think about what she does with her children through the day. But we also had to look at it from the context of the government or the country as a whole. And so we need to look at what the government can do, which will support several Hauers. So I'd like to focus on the skill issue. We do think that trying to give Hauer formal education today is probably not as useful as vocational education that prepares her for owning her clothing business. We also felt that it's important that the government is as closely involved in this as possible. And so we agree with the focus on having vocational centers, but we also think that we need something broader, which is a fully equipped small business enabler and rural pack, which has all the things that she needs. It has a creche, it provides electricity all the time. It allows her to learn how to sew or how to develop her creative skills in fashion. And it needs also to make sure that when she's able to develop that business, that business can sell what it is that she produces, such that that country becomes competitive. We also need to be able to protect the fashion industry that develops from the many Hauers in that country from some of the subsidized imports that will stop people on focusing on helping her build her business. So we do think that there's a strong connect between building her skills, creating an enabling environment, and providing support services, as well as providing financing. Mm. We feel that a lot of the financial institutions that work in many countries are very focused on big businesses, or at the minimum, small and medium scale enterprises. So to enable them focus on a Hauer, what we need to do is make sure that the government is able to provide risk sharing arrangements, financing that allows banks to feel that they can provide funding or loans to a Hauer without worrying about the loan losses that they could make, just to encourage them to focus on that sector. So we do think that the three areas are interconnected: financing, skills, as well as business support services, and that you must handle it at the macro level, but you must make it work at the micro level for
absolutely.
A Hauer.
Yes. And she can start small. I think it was table 16 where I heard that she could maybe start with school uniforms. It was table 16, right? I think I picked up that from that particular table. Let's see what else is here. So a mentorship program, peer-to-peer networking. What would that mean, table 18? If somebody could just explain that to us. Mentored by whom? Because I think what we've seen with experience, particularly if how, and I'm going to make a huge assumption here and say she's located in an outlying rural area, maybe there are no peers there. Maybe there isn't. All the people she could look for up to are people who now have moved to the urban area. So maybe you want to clarify your own point. I don't like making assumptions.
Yes, that was in reference to a point that I had made. My name is Edward. I'm a global change maker. So I'm a young person, and as a 20-year-old activist, I recognize that we don't operate in isolation and that young people need a platform upon which to share their ideas and a platform upon which to engage with one another and identify opportunities. So in other words, we are what we were saying when making that statement is that we need to equip Hawa with a network that will enable her to participate in her own socioeconomic emancipation. So through peer-to-peer networking, she's able to speak to other young women like herself, and attain some sort of self-determination.
Great. Any ideas or any examples of that happening and that being done? Well, I think you probably wanted to add to.
No, I wanted to say something completely different because I have dealt with several Hawas in my country. I'm a development finance institution. I head one. And we recognize that even though we have very big banks that fund big businesses, that those that are underserved don't have any access at all to funding. So as the head of the development finance institution, we decided that we were going to focus on the Hawas, which would involve an inclusive, sustainable development. And in order to do that, we have to start with the skills. Because as you said, it's too late to train them, it's too late for any education. So we get people like Hawa. She is the only outspoken one you've seen in that village. There are probably others. So what we do, we get a team of them together, 10, 15, 20, and train them in terms of capacity. We get people who understand not just the skills to be able to do the design work, but the skills to manage a small business. So we start there. When we have gotten them, we have to get them to commit themselves. It is one thing to say you don't have any funds, but you have to commit yourself. So we insist that they also contribute a certain percentage of the funds. So we start with 10%. And then they guarantee each other like a cooperative, and they start out. And what we have seen happen is that especially with the women, it's 100%, none of them defaults, because, and it has grown. As a corporate, at the end of 1 year, some of the times we migrate them to small businesses because then they can stand on their own. And then we go from not just skills creation, job creation, we now go to the next level of wealth creation. And those that cannot stand on their own begin to form other cooperatives, and it has worked. It's fantastic. It starts with the design. We have others, purely literate women in villages that do shea butter, and we're taking them to all kinds of levels. So it's something that can work. A Hawa in Africa is a Hawa that can become something great. Thank you.
Oh, love that. Let's move to Suzanne. We're running out of time, but let's move to Suzanne. We still have Aristide and Abra, and we're going to get to them, I promise. Everybody will be covered, but let's get to Suzanne. So Suzanne's vision is an Africa where health no longer impedes growth, and I think it was that last row there that was dealing with Suzanne. And a lot of what I heard as I walked up and down that row was around the need for partnerships, public-private partnerships, but I loved what was said at table 31 about ensuring that we're not reinventing the wheel. So maybe table 31, can someone there just share with us a little bit about, because I heard that there were examples being thrown around there as well.
At our table, what we decided first of all as the basic ground rules was business focuses, or the private sector focuses on business, and government should focus on education, infrastructure, and healthcare. And then the question was, how do we actually get government to deliver healthcare? first step, we said, is it's not just a question of just delivery or implementation, which we agreed would probably be through some element of private-public sector participation. But we said it in designing the model. And, you know, we've had the benefit in the last 20 years or so of seeing other developing countries or other parts of the world, Eastern Europe, Latin America, certain parts of Asia, who have gone through similar things or similar challenges as we're still facing, being the last frontier, so to speak. So we said we believe that the private sector should work very closely with government in designing and coming up with a model and looking at what has happened in other parts of the world. The private sector is very used to finding innovative solutions to problems where there's a profit motive. So we believe this is a very important thing that needs to be done. Thank you.
Any other thoughts on healthcare, on achieving Suzanne's vision?
Thanks, Siki. Our group had about five YGLs in it, so if we were portfolio managers, we'd be long or overweight on YGLs. So a lot of energy in our group, and we are focused on your title, which is Vision to Action. And one very actionable idea Fidel forwarded for our group, which we adopted, and we hope that any policymakers that are with us today will take this forward. It doesn't need to be something that's collaborative. Anyone that's involved in the education system, from the point of view of in African society, teachers are respected, firstly. Secondly, there are schools all over the country, in townships, in rural areas, etc. So if we made sure that basic healthcare modules were part of the teacher training curriculum, that teachers all over the country would be able to deliver basic paramedic assistance, basic emergency assistance, and that basic kind of education in their communities, that is something that would make a huge difference from the point of view of both preventative healthcare and assisting where there is no clinic or hospital nearby. So that for us is something which is immediately actionable. Over and above that, general preventative healthcare in terms of sending hygiene messages by SMS, on TV, radio, in language that is accessible, immediately accessible, that's something that public healthcare system can easily do. People are also able to access nutritional information. And lastly, we all know that you can buy a Coke anywhere in Africa. You may not have a hospital there, but you can buy a Coke and probably some airtime for your mobile phone. So those distribution channels can also be used to deliver basic pharmaceutical products, tablets for purifying water, etc. So that's us, table 32, long on YGLs. Thanks.
Absolutely. So someone doesn't have to travel 5 hours just to get a panado. All right, we're going to move on from Suzanne, and let's talk about Aristide. My vision is an Africa that can use its rich resources in a more sustainable and inclusive manner and improve the lives of my grandchildren. Haven't we all heard that refrain about our so-called resource curse? So I'd be very, very interested to see what people who were dealing with Aristide had to say about this. But there was one comment that I heard that I loved, and I didn't scribble down the table number, but someone said, we need to start taking ownership, that we need to firstly realize and recognize that these mineral resources are ours, and the companies that are extracting them are merely enablers. And I hope I'm not misrepresenting the person who said something to that effect. So it starts with firstly recognizing that this is a resource that belongs to everybody. So use it to help the entire country. And then I heard that one actually about diversifying economic activities, this over-reliance on one sector, and when there's a downturn, and then suddenly the whole country's economy collapses because all you are doing was focusing on one sector. So let's see what else came up. So financial ownership, developmental agenda in a sovereign wealth fund,
focus on growth, beneficiation, local value addition, linkages between mining and agriculture explored and promoted, improve bandwidth to communities by using mining companies as a backbone. Any thoughts on helping Aristide? Maybe you didn't deal with his specific issues, but you have some thoughts on it.
Thank you very much. Our table very quickly dived into the question of whether nationalization was a an outcome that could deliver this. And we came of that came to that conclusion through the question of how do we give Aristide and his grandchildren a stake in the resources that are intrinsically theirs by being citizens of the country in which either the mining asset or the oil and gas asset may exist. And so we went through the debate around what do we mean by nationalization, and I think came to the conclusion that it's a subject that needs to be properly unpacked and understood and unpicked and set against the free market existing paradigms of crowding in capital using free market principles. The conclusion we came to was that actually there is a way to try and build partnerships between the stakeholders in both oil and gas and mining assets in countries. Partnerships is a concept that we should be trying to promote so that we can deliver some of a more effective, equitable distribution to both the owners of the asset, the intrinsic owners of the assets, the citizens, and the providers of risk capital, and create a competitive environment for them. A critical cornerstone to any debate or engagement on this point is that you have to have fair, accountable, and responsible government in place to do it. Otherwise, neither party is going to get to the negotiating table to truly understand what that partnership could mean.
Any other points people want to raise on Aristide? Inclusive growth is something I think we were talking about a little bit earlier as well. And lessons from emerging markets, improving state capacity to regulate good practice for preventing environmental harm. And something else, actually hosted a discussion this morning on the radio about this specifically. And we were talking about, you know, how communities around a mining area are dealt with by those who are mining in a specific area, because here in South Africa we have many, many ghost towns that were once thriving mining towns. And surely if, you know, something used to, so you did something before and it didn't work out, going forward you need to think differently. So maybe some ideas on how to make sustainability not just a buzzword that we throw around when we want to make ourselves feel good. One here.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm called Eddie Gisheru Okech, a global change maker from Kenya. On the idea of sustainability, I want to borrow heavily on what we have shared together about the stories of our, the stories of Aristide and the rest. I think that all these people are an epitome on African society in a bigger picture. And if we talk about sustainability with regards and respect to this year's World Economic Forum theme, which is moving from vision to action, I think there's a big disconnect, even in all that you have shared, between us and these people, which I think is a picture of what Africa is like. When we talk, for instance, about how somewhere we're talking about our situations, our states, and everything, we talk about microfinance, we talk about emerging markets. They don't understand this language. How do we connect with these people? That is where action comes in.
Yeah.
Because if you talk about an hour who is 19 years old, a young lady who has not been to school, you're talking about emerging markets, you're talking about financial aid. This is a story of desperation at the end of the day. And I think this is what Africa has become of, a story of desperation, because there's a serious disconnect between us who have got some education,
yeah,
between us who have got some platform, and these people who have not got this platform. So there need to be some connection between us and these people in the African sense. That is when you can talk about sustainability. that's what the point I need to make.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Final avatar, and that is Abra. So let's have a look at Abra. We've got about 10 minutes left, so I will be wrapping up in about 10 minutes. So Abra's vision is an Africa with less infrastructure bottlenecks and more energy access to facilitate the development of business. Now, I'm sure you could go in all sorts of different directions to talk about this, and as you can see, transportation, communication, financing, using technology to get access to markets, feedback mechanisms between public and private sectors, cross-border integration. It's actually something I can't tell you which table it was, but you know, where they were saying that, what's the point of building a road all the way up until the border? And then once you've crossed the border, there's nothing there. You know, you might as well have cross-border, you know, agreements. If one country can do it or can provide the infrastructure for the region and you find some way of making it work, then why not? If you can build a dam in Lesotho that is going to also feed South Africa with water, why not do it, as long as there are agreements and partnerships in place? So that was one of the things I picked up a little bit earlier. Any thoughts on infrastructure? There's one here.
Hi. What we talked about here was just looking at the basic way to drive her business is driving around energy, proper energy, adequate energy infrastructure, looking at power generation right across the continent, distribution and transmission. If to run, for Abra to run an effective business, you need to integrate this well in getting the right deliverables so she can get her goods and services to market at the right price. That's one. Another area we looked at, which is very important, is water security on the continent. It's been missed by a lot of government, but it's important. It should be a very strong point on the continent that every African deserves access to water. Irrespective of the business you're in, if there is no water, then I don't see how that business could thrive. If you think about it, in as much as she could drive or build a good business, and she's not got access to good, clean water, then what follows up is sickness, and she spends the money in trying to eradicate or get rid of, you know, the diseases and stuff. So that's another area. The last area we looked at is supporting infrastructure in transportation. Efficiency in adequate network, not only in building the roads, but maintaining the roads. You just said there's no point building a great road from South Africa linking the neighboring country and you cross the border and the roads are not there. Then at the end of the day, the goods and services are still not going to be delivered on time. So it should be a charter on the continent. In making this happen as a goal, a lot of the African countries and the government should make it a mandatory position in involving private sector in trying to make this work. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi. So our group touched on the cross-border integration of Table 5. And what, you know, when we look at the case here and the story you know, behind Abra, is the one thing we're trying to get to is better public-private partnership. Because you know, when we look at the way that it's done right now, I think businesses want to integrate more with government and tell them what's going on and actually force certain change to make, you know, to remove these obstacles that are in the way. And with Abra in particular, you know, we felt that she should be more vocal, maybe, you know, but one thing which is important afterwards is the feedback mechanism. So after you've got government to do certain things, at least tell them what's working, tell them what's not working. Yeah. It's not good enough just raising your hands about an issue and then they deliver an issue and then over time it decays. You've got to keep that feedback mechanism going. And then we also touched on the cross-border integration. Again, the same problem with, you know, building a road to a border and then what. But it was more about not just that. What about customs and tariffs and the other trade barriers to trade that exist between African states in particular, and how to remove those so that manufacturing companies can ship across borders easily. It's no good getting into the border in 2 days or 1 day and then waiting 90 days for it to get through the border and into the stores.
All right, we're going to have to leave it there, but let me do this and just point out a few things that might also, because the whole point of this is obviously to kickstart the World Economic Forum on Africa. You're going to be attending a lot of sessions, and a lot of what we talked about this afternoon is going to come up there. And, you know, we talked a little bit about mobile phones when it came to the Avatar Oyore. So there's a technology update called The Next Leap Forward. There's a session looking specifically at that, and we spoke about education for Hauer, and there's a session called From Universal to University Education, and there's another one, Ideas Labs, with University of Cape Town and the London School of Economics. If you're thinking skills development, there's one about unlocking small and medium-sized enterprises. Health, we were talking about health with Suzanne, public-private partnerships there. So healthy business, healthy people is a session. Another session, innovative partnerships for development. And horrible handwriting someone has, and I can't see what that is. But there's resources, earth, minerals, the treasure underground. It's going to talk a little bit to what we're saying with Aristide, and also on diversification, talking a bit about the state of manufacturing. Just to help you navigate your way around the World Economic Forum on Africa as well, you'll find in your packs, we have the full program. This one, quite detailed. It'll tell you who's speaking, when, and on what, and the specific themes that are going to be highlighted. But if you're like me, and you get lost quite a bit, and you don't like to read too much of the detail, there's a little map. I think it's the first time we're having this. And it'll give you just an overview like that of all the different sessions. And at the back, which is perfect, it tells you exactly what's happening, where, why, and how. Thank you so much for your participation with us this afternoon, and really, I wish you a fantastic forum. Bye-bye.